Dr. Steve Klasko. Dr. Klasko is president of Thomas Jefferson University and CEO of Jefferson Health. And in 1 year, he was ranked the number two most influential speaker in healthcare policy. He's written an awful lot of books. He has a new one that just came out that maybe he can tell us about. Although this is my favorite, We Can Fix Healthcare. He talks about 12 disruptions that are coming and perhaps needed. And he's not afraid to talk about tearing down our current dysfunctional system and rebuilding it. And I think he is doing that as a leading a hospital and an academic medical center himself. And I think, and I talked to him a little bit a while back in a podcast, that COVID is accelerating a lot of this disruption that maybe might have felt painful and it was going to take years, and maybe it's going to happen quickly. So that leads into a lot of things, including telehealth. But Dr. Klasko, thanks so much for speaking, and looking forward to hearing what you see as the future for us, and don't be afraid to be disruptive.
I never have, Daniel, so thank you, and I really appreciate you inviting me to this great summit, and it was actually great hearing David's thoughts, and I'll have some things to say about that also. And I do agree with you, by the way, that I don't think the pandemic changed a lot that we didn't already know about what was wrong about healthcare, what needed to transform, change, disrupt. It just accelerated it. I do want to speak about the future. And
if you have slides, if you share a screen, then
we can see. Yeah, I want to do that, but I also want to make sure that I can play the sound.
Yeah.
So let's just get that.
Okay. And we can hear you good.
Okay, share a computer sound. Yeah, okay, good. Okay. Share. Let's see if that.
I have to say, just while you're getting things ready, a faculty member in here in healthcare administration, we were planning for the future and talking about healthcare, and he said, you know, you got to get the best guy in the country that's leading the charge on this, Dr. Klasko. So that was my mission, so I'm so happy that we have you here.
All right, I think we figured out the, I think we've got this done. Share. Good. Okay, great.
Type your password.
Let me just put my password in.
No, you don't need your
okay. Are you hearing me, Daniel?
Yes.
We just tested this.
We can hear you. We can see your slides, and we can see you. So I think we're good.
Yeah, no problem. There you go. Now you should be able to hear.
Are you guys hearing me?
Yes.
Okay, good. Okay. Fantastic. So I actually want to, before I start talking about the future, I actually want to go to the past and talk about 1979. Daniel, I was a senior medical student, and I think we talked about this on your podcast, but I started my career as a DJ. But as a senior medical student, I was asked in 1979, first time I had ever given a talk, about how medical students viewed the future and what they were concerned about. And the reason I remember it was the first time I had ever seen the Rolling Stones. They were one of my favorite
groups. You can't always get what you want. You can't always get what you want.
That's what they sounded like back then. And what I talked about back then is, gosh, can we get physicians to embrace change and be more optimistic about the future? Can we do anything to reduce health inequities? Because it seems like there's a lot of disparities in Philadelphia. And by the way, my bank just got an ATM, and why can't healthcare do cool things like that? And I remember being really nervous about the talk I was about to give, and I went to see a movie that nobody really thought would make it, about a rebel alliance. So if I was giving this talk in 2019, pre-pandemic, I would have said, by the way, the Rolling Stones are still on a tour. This is what they sound like.
Now you can't always get what you want.
And then I would say that Mick still can't get what he wants, and we're still talking about, as the CEO of a large system, can we get physicians to embrace change and be more optimistic about the future? Can we do anything to reduce health inequities? And how come I can do all my holiday shopping the day after Thanksgiving while I'm in my pajamas watching Game of Thrones, but if I have a stomach ache, I still have to get on the phone, listen to 11 options to get an appointment next Wednesday? And just as I was thinking about that in 2019, the number one movie of the year really wasn't much different. Star Wars, The Rise of Skywalker. So pre-pandemic, it's pretty amazing that not much has changed in 40 years. Now, Daniel, one thing clearly has changed. This was me in 1979. One of the things about getting old, I don't really miss the hair, but I truly miss the car. That was a 1968 GTO 400 four barrel. But I think it's clear to say that 2020 has been unprecedented in a lot of ways. And 2020 has changed a lot of the ways that we look at things. And certainly the nightmare on COVID Street that we have been dealing with over the last 6 months, beyond the incredibly just horrible toll that it has done to individuals and families, done to the economy, finances, et cetera. It's also, in many, many respects, really accelerated and accentuated really the bizarreness of the economics of healthcare. I mean, if you just want one set of facts, during the same quarter that that the American hospital providers have lost somewhere in the realm of about $300 billion, Anthem and insurers revenue ended that same quarter with a $2.3 billion profit, which was more than double its $1.1 billion profit from that quarter of last year. Cigna's profit grew to $1.8 billion during that pandemic quarter. Centene's profit doubled so that their profit was $1.2 billion compared to $495 million the same quarter, 2019. And our friends at United had a fantastic quarter. They doubled their net earnings to $6.6 billion. Again, so while folks were losing jobs, while all the things that David talked about were happening, while hospitals were literally laying off people, we had this huge fragmentation in between providers and payers. We also had an acceleration of technology. We started something called Jeff Connect back in 2013, invested about $35 million. It's one of the largest self-run telehealth programs. It took us 5 years from January 15th to January 20th to get to 100,000 visits, and we did 100,000 visits from February 20 to April 20. So the supply was there, the demand just became greater. And by the way, that also gets into a fragmentation, because once again, post-surge in places like Pennsylvania and New Jersey, insurers are back to paying one quarter or so of what they pay for in-person visits. So we're already starting to see some of those telehealth visits go down. But what we really want to talk about is 2030. And I thought what I would try to do is tell you what happened, if we could, get into a 2030 mindset and look back about what happened from 2020 on forward. So just to get you into that mindset, it's July of 2030. We have Ivanka Trump and Chelsea Clinton and Governor Cuomo all looking to become the next president. And you can Rolling Stones are still around. They're on the zombie tour. And yes, the Star Wars franchise is still going on. But even Yoda is pretty tired of it. But more importantly, healthcare has not broken, but smashed the cost, access, quality, and patient experience curve through a series of disruptive events and creative partnerships, which is something that we had all been waiting for. And so I thought I'd give you just sort of a little taste of a pandemic of 2030. So here's how it went. It's February 2nd, 2030. A mutant strain of an RNA encapsulated virus has been afflicting people in Australia. Of course, people old enough to remember, especially healthcare workers, the dark days of early 20 and the COVID-19 crisis, immediately panicked for about a second, and then they smiled because they knew that healthcare had evolved from this broken, fragmented, expensive, inequitable sick care system to a health assurance system where most of their care happens at home. Since most of your healthcare data is now continuously streamed to the cloud and AI bots are constantly analyzing them for any changes, The early symptoms of this new virus were immediately identified, and anyone throughout the world who exhibited those early symptoms was notified and asked to socially isolate. If needed, their employer was notified and asked for an excused absence. Software was immediately sent through the Internet of Things, now called the Internet of You, so your home 3D printer could begin to create masks for you and your family. Those who were having panic attacks, remembering the COVID-19 crisis, could immediately communicate with their bot psychiatrist, and if necessary, could immediately receive drone-delivered treatment. There were no lines or concerns about food or supply storages for the same reason. Humans are not the dependent variable, as the fourth industrial revolution of drones, AI, Internet of Things, and robotics have modified the supply chain, and there is no reason to congregate in crowded grocery stores or hoard toilet paper. The whole scare was over within a month, as new bioprocessing techniques were able to identify, develop, and test vaccines through rapid prototyping. Instruction for K-12 students continued seamlessly as the U.S. had finally reached broadband in 100% of households by 2025. And just as healthcare at home was mainstream, so were creative ways of teaching in a variety of venues. So how did we get here? How did we get from 2020 to 2030? Well, I want to point to Apple, and you mentioned Apple earlier. John Sculley was my commencement speaker this year at Thomas Jefferson University, and he talked about his first foray with Steve Jobs when he became the CEO. And he went to Steve and he said, Steve, we need a business plan. It's got to be one of those really big ones with lots of spreadsheets. And this is what Steve came up with as a three-year business and strategic plan. Year one, we change. Year two, we change the industry. Year three, we change the world. So what I thought I would do for the Healthcare Economics Summit is really sort of look at the changes that need to happen that way. What do we have to do to change? How do we change industry? And potentially, how can some of that change the world? So I want to get back to some of the things that David talked about with the Biden healthcare plan. But believe it or not, some of this fragmentation and the way this economics works is not new. One of my mentors at Wharton was a guy named Bill Kissick, who passed away in 2014. But he wrote a book 40 years ago called Medicine's Dilemmas, Infinite Needs, Finite Resources. Sound familiar? And 40 years ago, he talked about this iron triangle of access, quality, and cost. And he said, if you increase one angle, obviously you have to decrease another. So if you want to increase access, you either have to increase cost or decrease quality, et cetera. He said, unless you're willing to disrupt the system, and disruption is painful. He said in the 90s that if anybody tells you they're going to increase access, increase quality, and decrease cost, and it's not going to be painful, that's not the truth. So if you just think about it, President Obama with the Affordable Care Act and Obama-Biden said, good news, the Affordable Care Act will increase access, increase quality, and decrease cost, and it won't be painful. Not true. President Trump said, I think it'll be terrific, fantastic, unbelievable, and huge. Clearly not true. And I think exactly what David was talking about, these incremental changes are going to do nothing to really upset or transform or disrupt that iron triangle. Because if you think about it, if you're going to give more people access and the goal is to move a dollar and a quarter to a dollar, you would have sold all your middleman stocks. You would have sold all your for-profit insurers. You would have sold a lot of your supply chain stocks, because in every other industry where it's been disrupted by technology, those middle layers have gone down. Well, you would have made a big mistake, because those middleman stocks in healthcare went up by 10 or 11 times since the ACA. So I think we are at a once in a multi-generation moment, from an unhealthcare model of sick care to one of health assurance. And that is what our new book is about, from sick care to health assurance. And the best way to look at it is, and the book that I wrote most recently was written with a guy named Hemant Taneja, who's the managing principal of General Catalyst. General Catalyst was one of the initial investors in Airbnb, Warby Parker, Stripe. In every case, unscaling what was a big monolith of whether it's hotels or whether it was payment systems or finance. And their first foray into healthcare was a company called Livongo, which unscaled diabetes care and made more diabetes care at home. We were partners of Livongo from the very beginning. And that company literally has become a several billion dollar company whose IPO was one of the largest IPOs in healthcare history. But I think this is, in fact, and if you take nothing else out of this, we are approaching healthcare's Amazon moment. If you're a provider and think you're going to go back to your business model solely being based on hospital revenue and not relevant to people who want care at home, I think you'll be out of business. If you're an insurer and think you can just be the middleman between the hospital and the patient, you'll be irrelevant. If hospitals believe that innovation can be just this cute little thing they do in the background, but the real business is just getting heads in beds, they're nuts. I think we were always wondering what the big disruption would be that got us to join the consumer revolution, and I think this is it. So what I like to talk about is the iron triangle of healthcare. 95, not the iron triangle, but in essence, the patient diamond. 95% of people are not patients, they're people. They're people that want to be able to thrive and not have health get in the way. They're people that want to be able to connect and have human relationships when they need to for their health. They want to be able to easily navigate the system on their own terms. And they want to understand what they need to do. They want to know if they're getting a hip replacement and they're a half marathon runner, what's my chances if I go to Jefferson of running a half marathon in a year based on my outcomes? Exactly what will I have to pay? Not maybe, but what will I have to pay? Is there a discount if I pay it up front? Here's my insurance, you can figure it out. I want to know what other patients say about you. And then I want to know what your outcomes are. I want to know what your readmission rate is, what your infection rate is, and if any of those things happen that I don't pay for, that you pay for. And then I want to be able to go to some of your competitors like I can in everything else. So the real change, and it'll be very tough and disruptive, is we're going from hospital and doctor companies to consumer health entities. This is not far from the truth. We're running a little behind, so I'd like each of you to ask yourself, am I really that sick, or would I just be wasting the doctor's valuable time? From the physician administrator as the boss to the patient as the boss. So Jefferson, we got into that early. We talked about the old math of our two university campuses and our 14 hospitals, and the new math of innovation strategic partnerships. How can we share in the $1 trillion that will be spent on that disruption? In essence, we asked ourselves, can a 195-year-old academic medical center make it acting like a startup company? And we started with some sort of, at that time, very, very unusual assumptions, that we'd be paid based on quality, cost, patient experience, and outcomes, that our hospital stays, which were the core of our business, would be commoditized. It took us about 40 years to get doctors and nurses to work together. Now we're going to have to get doctors and robots to work together. And that given the above, why are we selecting humans to be really good robots by asking them to memorize things and take multiple choice tests? Wouldn't creativity, self-awareness, and empathy be the most important attributes and let the robots do the memorizing? And by the way, population health, predictive analytics, and social determinants of health need to move to the mainstream of clinical care, payment models, and medical education. In essence, that innovation became the most important of our four pillars around being the growth driver. So give you just one example that we had started Jeff Connect, and we had theorized that we could move about 50 to 60% of our patients that would have come to the ER to not have to come to the ER at much less cost, much more convenience through urgent care, direct telehealth, or next day office scheduling. The problem was, in our current fragmented insurance system with our six insurers, we got an average of somewhere around $1,400 if somebody came to our ER, whether they needed to or not, and an average of about $80 if we did it through one of these ways. So we concentrated on our employees, and we had 35,000 employees. And what we did was we said, new rule is $500 deductible if you just show up to our ER, zero deductible if you end up in our ER through Jeff Connect. Well, we were able to transition 60% of our non-trauma, non-ambulance ER visits into a much more convenient, better way of doing things at a huge cost savings to us with much better experience. So one of the things that's hit me as an obstetrician is the difference over the 30 or 40 years that I've been a doctor in how we handle an individual patient is amazing. The difference in how we deliver care and the healthcare delivery system is about the same. So we made a decision at Jefferson that, and if you come to my office, you'll see the first thing in my office is, our goal is to meet the needs of patients to access their healthcare in the flexible manner in which they consume every other consumer good. I hope that when you come to Philadelphia 5 years from now, and you ask where Jefferson is, that nobody can answer that. You mean Jefferson on my phone, or Jefferson in 12 micro hospitals, or Jefferson in 5 or 6 different partnerships? Oh, you mean the place where really, really, really sick people go to have transplants? I think that's still in downtown Philadelphia. And my good friend John Scully put it very well. He said, I don't think any of you get up in the morning and say, I think I'm going to telebank. It's just the banking move from 90% of the bank to 90% home. So John says, stop talking about the technology. Just start to get healthcare out to where people are in the most convenient way. And if you think about the pandemic, 30 years ago, we would have been talking about people lining up to deposit checks on Friday. And certainly we didn't have to do that. So Jefferson, we turned that whole model to healthcare with no address. The care, like everything else, should be digital. And I'm just going to give you a couple examples. We have an NCI cancer center. And believe it or not, in 2020, in most NCI cancer centers, if you're in Philadelphia or New York, and your daughter is in Milwaukee and your son is in Dallas, you're still calling your mom in New York or Philadelphia and saying, Mom, what did the doctor say? I don't know, he or she came in at 6 o'clock in the morning with 6 young people that look like they just got out of high school, but I think they're called the residents, but I'm confused. Maybe you'll get over to the nurse's station. Maybe you'll get a call back from the doctor. We started something called virtual rounds, where what we do is we say, who would you like to communicate with? I have a daughter in Milwaukee. I have a son in Dallas. We send them HIPAA compliant software. We text them when we're making rounds. And I had the chance to be an undercover boss last Father's Day. I had emergency lung surgery on a Thursday night. I had 3 children coming down to visit me, one from Alaska, one up from Tampa, and one down from New York. And all they knew was that dad had had emergency surgery. But 5 minutes out of anesthesia, this is not simulated, this is real, this was me with my surgeon, Dr. Nate Evans, and my 3 children on 3 different computers and iPads, being told by Dr. Evans that I'll be okay and they can come in. This was 5 minutes out of anesthesia. Now, all 3 of them said that I offered them cars, which is why we don't do it 5 minutes after anesthesia anymore. But the ability to connect people at home and loved ones at home with people having tertiary and coronary care. And on one hand, I was really excited about it. They did a Forbes article about this. On the other hand, I said, wait a second, we could have done this 3 years ago with FaceTime, or 5 years ago with Skype, or even 15 years ago on the phone, but the patients didn't demand it, and we didn't, frankly, care enough from a consumer perspective to make that happen. We now do 60% of our neuroscience post-op visits, because we have 36 different hospitals that use us for neuroscience. We do them, and they turn out like this.
Good morning, Mr. Lehman.
Good morning, Dr. Rosenwasser.
How are you feeling this morning?
Good. I feel very well. Actually, battling a cold and getting over that.
Okay. Any headaches?
No.
Can you turn your head so I can actually see the incision? All right. Well, we'll be in contact with the return appointment. And Maureen will be in contact with getting the RP Express back to us. All right, thanks very much.
All right, you too.
All right,
thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
I see your kid's looking in there. There he is, right behind you. Okay, yeah. How you doing?
Good. This is Dr. Rosenwasser, right. Jackson. Yeah, this is my son Jackson, my daughter Savannah.
Oh, hi, how are you? You kids should be off to school pretty soon, huh?
Yeah, they're going to be going to school very soon.
All right. Take care. Signing off.
So we saved that individual about 8 hours, and the family felt very confident that he was going to be okay. We sent them home with a robot that gave us a lot of the data that we would have gotten in the office. This is something we just started. As I mentioned, I'm an obstetrician. If you think about it, when I started my practice about 30 years ago, what would have happened is a 28-year-old patient might have figured she was late for her period. She might have gone to her 65-year-old male family doc, who would have said, congratulations, Mrs. Jones, you're pregnant. I'm going to send you to my obstetrician, Dr. Clasco. That's how I got most of my patients. The chances that today a young woman would just go to her male primary care doc, potentially, or even woman primary care doc, and then say, I'm going to go to whoever you tell me, are pretty remote. They're going to want to talk to friends. They're going to want to look things up on the internet. So we created a match.com between obstetricians and patients. Simply put, hi, I'm Denise Jones. I live in Bryn Mawr, Pennsylvania. You can GPS me I want a group within 10 miles of where I live. I want a predominantly female group that will accept my doula. I have Aetna Gold. I don't want to pay more of a deductible for my entire delivery than $1,000 or less. The only day I can really come in is Fridays because of my work. And by the way, if you're interested in being my obstetrician, could you please send me quality data you have and what your C-section rate is and what other and what patients say about you? And so I went around the country talking about this, and there was a lot of shooting the messenger. Because what I found is that about 50% of obstetricians said, oh my God, this is the end of days. The fact that this is what healthcare has come to. I am done practicing. This is ridiculous. I will never participate in this kind of match.com for patients. I had 50% of obstetricians say, wow, that's really cool. Where do I join up? Now, there was a huge age and gender difference between A and B, and you can probably guess the age and gender. This is an example of a project we did with Apple, where we were able to get on people's iPhones and Apple Watches, literally screening reminders. 60%, believe it or not, in 2020, with all the technology that exists, of reminders for colonoscopies come in the mail. And when we think about how important colonoscopies are for getting screening, the chances are you're going to forget to do that or at least delay it. We were able to show that we had a 70% increase in people literally booking their screening tests, whether it's colonoscopies or mammograms. While you might not want to see this in the middle of a date or the middle of a meeting, you're much more likely to tap to book it if it's that easy. So I think what I leave the we change is, I think the pandemic has proven that it's no longer a luxury. And while some of us have been in these boardrooms, clearly there's no question that we now have the choice of being Sears and Penny's or being Target and Walmart in this Amazon moment. And for Jefferson, our goal is to sort of be that interface between the consumer and their digital solutions. So what about changing the industry? Well, I want to start off with AI because I have the honor of being the co-chair of the Board of Stewards for the World Economic Forum on the new digital economy. And there's a lot of excitement about AI and robotics and drones and the fourth industrial revolution, and there's a lot of concern. Here's an example of the good. This is at our children's hospital, and this little critter actually is amazing at taking keywords from this young child with cancer, and really sort of assessing the child's moods and really becoming a friend to the child. Couldn't be better, and it's getting better all the time. Here's the bad. We tend to trust our technology a little too much. This is an example of a woman that followed her GPS into a lake because obviously the GPS would not drive her wrong. And we don't want to get into this kind of model where does your car have any idea why my car pulled it over? And then here's the ugly. And I think this is something that we spent a lot of time thinking about, whether it's IBM Watson giving unsafe recommendations for treating cancer or some of the deals that have been done that have really affected privacy and genomics, or even worse, the fact that if all AI does is take the last 10,000 people that have been arrested, and it turns out that some of that racial profiling that went on is now literally embedded into the AI systems, that's certainly the ugly part of what we do. So as we think of AI and we think about what's the role of the humans in AI, I've spent a lot of time on this as it relates to medical education. My colleague Rowan Molnar said technology will replace 80% of what doctors do. And Vino Kosla has been very articulate in saying any doctor that can be replaced by a computer should be. So we need an extreme makeover, disruption slash starting over for medical education. Because in some respects, we still accept doctors based on science, GPA, MCATs, and organic chemistry performance. And somehow we're just amazed that doctors aren't more empathetic, communicative, and creative. And then we put them through a residency. I went through a surgical residency. And I will tell you that self-awareness, empathy, social determinants are not usually the first things being taught, even in 2020. And I think Jack Ma at last year's World Economic Forum really put it best. And this is what he said.
No matter how artificial intelligence is good. Human being in the future competed with the machine on knowledge, you don't have chance. Computer is always going to be smarter than you are. When there's a car, forget about who runs faster. When there's a plane, don't think you can fly like a... When there's a computer, you know, computer is always smarter than you are. They never forget. They remember everything. They never get angry. They calculate faster. But computer can never be as wise as a man. What's the difference between smart and wisdom?
So how do we create wise doctors and nurses? Well, for any of you in the audience today, either virtually or out in Wisconsin, that are doctors, this might give you cold sweats, because literally the gateway to getting into medical school is being able to memorize complex formulas like this. Now, I don't know about you, but that's exactly who I want for my obstetrician, my family doctor, or my psychiatrist. And the fact is, it also really creates a tale of two cities. Because here's the rub. If the number one criteria to get into medical school is being able to memorize this and do multiple choice tests, MCATs, and there are people in Philadelphia, and I'm sure it's true in Milwaukee, that are spending $100,000 to get little Johnny or little Mary 5 Princeton reviews and 3 tutors so they can really get all the tricks to memorize those things. And by the way, that's without even photoshopping their picture on a crew member illegally. And then there's another child with a battered Barron's book. That's really not an even playing field. And that's a good part of the reason that back in 1978, we had 4% of matriculating medical students were African-American males. And in 2018, that number had stayed at 4%, because we've literally lived in a 1970s and 80s mentality of who ought to be a doctor. So we started the first medical school in the country where we chose students based on self-awareness, empathy, communication skills, and cultural competence, 56 students a year. And we partnered with two very unusual admissions partners. One was Southwest Airlines, because in many ways, that's how Southwest chooses pilots. They used to choose them based on the simulator. You were 95th percentile, you were 93rd percentile. So that's what we're doing it on. Now they realized after about 92nd percentile, technically it's all the same. If something happened in the cockpit, they look for your first reaction and your first reaction. And basically the person with the clipboard is a behavioral therapist looking at how you communicate and handle that. So this was in our new medical school, one of the criteria. We would take them to this art museum and show them this and say, what do you see? And an applicant might go, I see a woman in a white dress, a guy in a black turtleneck and a snake. Okay, I get that. But what's this emoting to you? What are you feeling when you see this piece of art? I'm feeling there's a woman in a white dress and a black guy in a black turtleneck and a snake. Okay, but what emotion are you feeling? Well, there's a guy in a black turtleneck, a woman in a white dress, and a snake. Another applicant might right away get into the story and see some subtle hints about that story and tell the story. I think the dress is ill-fitting. I think that represents the relationship between the man and the woman, et cetera. It almost doesn't matter what the story is. And you might say, Steve, why does that matter? Well, I've delivered a couple thousand babies, and it's pretty easy delivering a normal 7.5-pound baby to a normal 30-year-old patient. And it's easy for me to say, I'm on the other end, but it's medically easy. It's incredibly hard delivering an unscheduled Down syndrome baby or unscheduled baby with congenital anomaly. And 100% of the time, the first question out of that patient will be, doctor, what does it mean? And I've watched good obstetricians that probably did very well on their MCATs and are really good at memorizing things, talking about the trisomy 21 and the medical complications that the patient, that the baby might have. I've watched great obstetricians right away get the, what does it mean? Means that means, what does it mean to my image of a perfect baby? And will right away say, you know what? This is a beautiful baby. I will get you together with other people that have had beautiful babies like this. That 30 seconds could be the entire difference between how that mom, and in some cases that dad, interacts with the baby. And here's the rub. There's a 100% chance that 5 years from now, there'll be an IBM Watson or a Google Brain or something else next to me that will be better at taking a picture of that baby, going into its database of 25,000 genetic anomalies, and saying exactly what's wrong with that baby. I don't care how good your human brain is. But it, the Google Brain or the IBM Watson, will never get the what does it mean means what does it mean to my image of a perfect baby. So the concept of taking AI to allow us to create doctors and nurses and healthcare professionals that really are great humans, that are good at science, but are great humans, is starting to segment the class. So there are physician scientists that maybe do have to memorize those cycles, but folks that are really going into practice have self-awareness, empathy, communication skills, and cultural competence. And by the way, what we found is that when you start to choose people on that, you get a much, much, much more diverse class. And they're overemphasizing tech scores, whether it's in a residency or medical school, as this study showed, may make residency programs too white and too non-diverse. So we have taken it on ourselves as the fourth largest medical school in the country to teach our health professionals to be ready for what will happen 10 years from now today. And one of the things that we did when I graduated from Wharton, I got a almost $1 million grant to look at what makes physicians different than, depending on the audience, either other people or normal people in how we handle change. And as part of that study, what we found is that nationally, 70% of physicians practicing 3 years or less felt they didn't learn what they most need in practice. In fact, what they said is, thanks so much. I have $250,000 worth of debt, and you taught me exactly half of what I need to know. Taught me a lot of biochemistry, microbiology. You taught me a lot of nephrology and endocrinology, but I'm not really using a whole lot of that. What you didn't teach me is how to manage change, and there's a heck of a lot of that. You didn't teach me how to negotiate. You didn't teach me anything about bizarre healthcare financing or even how to effectively communicate or make patients happy. I'm in a large group. You didn't teach me much about being an individual in an organization or running an effective meeting. Or I'm hearing a lot about AI, drones, robotics. You really didn't teach me any of that. And now I'm starting my practice and I'm pretty cool.
Traditionally, we've been masters at memorization, having this knowledge that other people don't have, that our patients don't have. But as we look forward and kind of like peak 20 years into the future, that kind of superpower that we have and knowledge, that's going to be shrinking with artificial intelligence and machine learning, and we really need to tap into a different skill set. And I believe that doctors are creative people, and that creativity is actually one of the most important skill sets that a physician needs. And so we built the Health Design Lab, and I love it. It's a space for us to really use our imaginations in thinking about how to solve challenges in healthcare. And in medicine, we don't get that.
So that is actually in a 195-year-old vault in Philadelphia where we put our healthcare design lab. And if you think about it, so much of healthcare education is look to the left, look to the right. One of you will get into medical school. Then it'll look to the left, look to the right. One of you will get the best residency. And when I went to Wharton, and many of you were probably MBAs, really the most important decision you had to make, at least that's what they told us, was your study group, because every grade you got would be a study group grade. They threw the 100 of us in a room and said, get somebody from accounting, somebody from finance, somebody from marketing, somebody from management. Now, of course, it was sort of really tough for me because people said, what are you? I said, I'm a gynecologist, and nobody wanted me in their study group. But once I got into a study group, literally, I learned how to be creative and interdependent, which is almost the opposite of where traditional healthcare education has been. So to that end, this is the individual that I wrote my new book with. His name is Hemant Taneja. Hemant is managing principal at, as I mentioned, at General Catalyst. And he wrote a book about 2 years ago called Unscaled. And it was based on the work that they had done with Airbnb and Warby Parker and what at that time was a brand new IPO called Livongo. The 20th century principles of mass production and economies of scale were going to see to mass personalization and rentable scale. We know that. We've seen that happen with Netflix and Blockbuster, with Uber and taxis. I used to say with Digital and Kodak, but I guess Kodak has done pretty well with their new defense contract. But our book is called Unhealthcare, A Manifesto for Health Assurance. And basically what it prescribes is that the pandemic has proven, in some respects, the pandemic has proven that Bernie Sanders, Senator Sanders, was 100% right about the problem of American healthcare. I would also argue that the pandemic has proven that that Bernie Sanders was 100% wrong about the solution. So when Senator Sanders says that we have a fragmented, expensive, sick care, hospital-driven, insurer-driven healthcare system that is really there to support the inefficiency and the corporate profits of each of those sectors, he couldn't be more right, and the pandemic has proven that. I think the let's have the federal government and states run it. I think most of us would argue that that probably doesn't make a whole lot of sense. And I think one of the things, before I go further, one of the things that if you read the book, you'll see is there's been this myth that healthcare is complicated. It's not that it's that complicated. As somebody that's been doing it for 45 years, both on the front line and in administration and now running 14 hospitals, it's not that complicated. It's just that we haven't had the profiles of courage of changing some of the things that we have to change. We haven't had the profiles and courage of changing the fact that we shouldn't have insurers that are based on medical loss ratios of how much can I get in from the employer and how little can I pay out. We shouldn't have hospitals that are literally make their entire living based on how can I get sick people into my hospital. And the fact that there's a 21-year difference in life expectancy in my community is not my problem. We shouldn't have pharma be able to charge retail to our largest payer, the government. We shouldn't have 10-to-1 differences in what the cost of end of life and the last 6 weeks of life are. And we shouldn't have a payment of physician system where orthopedic surgeons and dermatologists might make 9 or 10 times what family doctors make. And then we're asking family doctors to be the quarterback of new systems. And just think about this for a second. We've asked our family doctors to be the quarterbacks of the system. And as one of my chairs in family medicine said, Steve, if you want me to be the quarterback, you have to stop paying me like the kicker. Because right now we get paid much, 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 much less. So the concept of one healthcare is that costly sick care will give way to affordable, personalized, and preemptive care with genomic sensors and AI-based digital therapies. And really what our goal, and we're doing this both with a group of entrepreneurs, technologists, doctors, founders, and executives, we're partnering with the World Economic Forum to look at how we can use data, technologies, and talent to commit to providing individuals and populations a path to living their healthiest life. What if we started to look at people as people and not patients that might someday fill my hospital beds? Just one example of sick care to health assurance is what's happening in obstetric care in this country. So there are technologies now where you can get most of your obstetric testing at home. Now think about this world post-pandemic. A normal patient who needs to be have her pregnancy tested, unlike most countries, the way we do it in this country is we say, we want you to come 3 times a week into my hospital to get tested. The chances that somebody post-pandemic are gonna say, let me get this straight, Steve. You want me to come into Jefferson 3 times a week, pay $35 to park, go to a place where there's a lot of sick people, get in an elevator, have somebody slap a monitor on me so I can look up at the ceiling and 2 hours later have a nurse come and tell me that my baby's okay, when I could be at home drinking lemonade, watching Little Fires Everywhere, having somebody come on my iPad and tell me the same thing. So I think we are in this seminal moment that technology will start to take that, and hospitals and health systems that aren't willing to do that will quickly go the way of Sears and Penney's. And I think we'll start to see it in areas like obstetrics at the beginning where people feel healthy when they come in. I think one of the issues is how do we change the payment model? And it was interesting to hear David before talk about Candidate Biden's goals. I think it will take more than tweaking because this is an old Upton Sinclair quote. It's hard to get someone to do something when their salary depends upon them not doing it. And right now, all of us, whether you're a health system that's getting paid for doing things in the hospital, or insurer that's getting paid based on medical loss ratios, or a pharma company that's getting paid based on literally selling more of your drugs, that's not going to contract the system. So how do we move from sick care to health assurance? How do we move from a hospital home, from the physician administrator as the boss, to patient as the boss? How do we move from static to continuous data? A lot of work in the book was done on the concept of the physical. There's a lot of things wrong with the physical. The concept of going in once a year or once every 2 years to get a static view of your data and then have you have the next year or two be based on that really makes no sense. And in many ways, your car gets better care than that. My car, while it's in the garage, is sending continuous data. And when I get up in the morning and I start my car, it might say, hey, Steve, you know, while you were sleeping, my right passenger, front passenger tire got a little flat. Before you get your coffee, could you go ahead and fill it up? But we still have people dying in their sleep from atrial fibrillation. So the concept of going once a year and saying, on July 31st of 2020, your pulse is this, your blood pressure is this, your EKG is this, your calcium score is this, this is what you should do for the next year or two, really makes no sense. And as the technology of wearables and some of the other opportunities to continuously monitor, that will change that. The other problem with the physical is it totally ignores everything above the head. And again, at Jefferson, we started a whole brain health program recognizing that that's going to be a major part of things. And then how do we look at the humans in the system, whether it's the doctors or the nurses, and make sure that they're more human? And finally, we talked about changing the industry. How do we change the world? Well, that's a lot harder. Most of you will be able to answer this, but what contributed most to your chances of becoming infected with COVID-19 in 2020? Your genetics, lack of social distancing, your zip code? By far, it was your zip code. We had a 5 times increased chance of people getting infected and dying of COVID based on zip codes in Philadelphia more than anything else. So how do we get robots and humans over the next 10 years to work together to provide better care? And I think one of the things we have to recognize is that we talk about existential threats to the globe. And one of them certainly is climate change, but the other is how do we really start to affect these health disparities? And I think one of the things that's hit me is that I don't think enough attention has been paid, in my opinion, as we've had a reawakening of some of the racial and social inequities in this country to healthcare disparities. And in fact, in 1966, Dr. Martin Luther King, in 1966, 54 years ago, said, of all the areas of civil injustice, the disparities in healthcare are the most inhumane. And in that 54 years, we haven't changed, at least in a city like Philadelphia, and many other cities in this country, and I would argue in the world, the disparity in life expectancy based on zip code. So one of the things that we've been working with the World Economic Forum and some of the entrepreneurs in Silicon Valley and Boston and others is how can we start to affect these large-scale transformations in healthcare that will allow us to both survive as a business and have a positive societal outcome? How can we make sure that the fourth industrial revolution will give us the tools and data to do this and proactively, and the word is proactively, address the human and ethical consequences? And the way I would look at this, if we knew when the Industrial Revolution happened that the internal combustion engine would contribute to climate change, we might have made some changes. If we knew that the agricultural revolution, the corn-based agricultural economy, would cause as much obesity as it did, we might have looked at things a little differently. And certainly, given the testimony of the last several days in Congress, if we knew that the social media revolution would be more than just, I want to see my kids on Facebook or grandkids on Facebook, but would actually potentially affect elections and allow people to spew hate, I think we would have gotten ethicists and others involved earlier. So what we're really pushing for is getting sort of the ethical consequences, the human consequences, much, much earlier into the whole discussion around the fourth industrial revolution. So we're not sitting here 10 years from now saying, why did this happen? And there's some things we know that will happen. We know that healthcare and academic success will require disruption in our way of thinking, creative partnerships to create new ecosystems. And again, as I started out with, it will definitely be painful for those who don't want to think differently as these new ecosystems are built. We have to recognize that and allow the Sears and Pennies of healthcare and academics to fail. So in our world is really looking at obsession toward making what's difficult in healthcare easier. And as I look and conclude, this is what I firmly believe, that by the next 2 years, 25% of large health systems will be providing real-time genomic-based decision support at the time of treatment writing. We're already doing a lot of that, but we need to make sure that privacy is built in to that genomic-based decision support. By 2024, 20% of the population with chronic conditions will be relying on virtual health assistants, like Livongo did for diabetes, for wellness management. Within the next several years, health systems will have moved from a sick care model, that health policy will reward healthy choices, food and home environment will become the variables in how health systems are paid. And certainly by the time of that next pandemic of 2030, the majority of interactions will be virtual or remote, and the majority of those will involve AI or machine cognition applications. So literally the kind of disruption that we had, people's health will not be the same. And in fact, one of the things that we're dealing with in 2020 is what we've come to call the pandidn't. I didn't get my mammogram. I didn't get my colonoscopy. I didn't get tested for my chest pain. And I think what we will find out when the book is written about the 2020 COVID-19 pandemic is that many, many people, especially people in lower socioeconomic zip codes, died not of COVID, but of the fact that they didn't get tested. They didn't want to go into the ER for their chest pain or for the stroke pieces. And some of this is, and some of the things we're most excited about, at Jefferson, the technology that we've invested in that has had probably the most success, at least in 2020, is looking at fibers and textiles for wearables. That really the new normal will be not all the different Oura Rings and Apple Watches, but that what you're wearing will send constant data. And this is not science fiction. We're not very far from this model.
You had 5 asthma attacks last week, David. What's going on?
Not feeling well. I got a cold starting. Had to go to Barstow twice for work.
Barstow's nice and dry. What's your asthma keeping you from doing?
Yeah, well, normal life for starters. Like walk upstairs, play with the kids, go see a movie.
Okay, well, here's some weather for you. And I can't say it's nice out. Your neighborhood AQI is 160, humidity's down, and particulate matter's up, so you'll have a 65% increased risk of an attack today. You got some popcorn in the house?
Sure. I get it. Not going out today.
Right. And keep your Advair inhaler nearby.
Okay. Every 2 hours, I take one shot, right?
That's it. You want me to remind you when you need to take it?
Send me an SMS.
Okay. Talk with you soon.
And by the way, one of the most interesting social experiments, I believe, which was discussed by the CEO of UPS, at one of the conferences, the CEO of UPS said, we need to become a 5G company. He said, well, why? You're the guys with the brown shorts and the brown trucks. Well, in their opinion, 90 or 95% of deliveries will be drone deliveries, and 5G will disrupt the latent phase and speed of drone deliveries. And so it'll be easier in some respects for Huawei or Verizon to become a transport company that might be for the traditional transport companies to compete with that. And if you start to take that to the next level in changing the world, and you think about food deserts, you start to think about healthcare policy that could say, Mrs. Jones, you're on government assistance for food and healthcare. If you're willing to use that government assistance to serve your family healthy food, everything's barcoded, we'll give you 50% more assistance for your family. And by the way, we'll drone deliver it so that there really isn't any concept of food deserts. So those are the kind of creative things that I hope one candidate over this next election will start to look at. One of the questions that got put in the chat room, which I think is a great question from Jonathan Fritz, Chief Innovation Officer of Chime, a great organization that I know, is how do we learn from our EHR mistakes of the past for implementing telehealth and remote care and how will we enable the fully engaged healthcare consumer? Great, great question. And I think it speaks to the fact that the traditional EMRs are probably the first progress in technology that has actually required us to hire more humans just to get back to where we were before, since most of us have hired scribes. And I would argue that what we're looking at doing with General Catalyst and Haemont is exactly the kind of partnership that needs to happen. Because what happened is 20 years ago or whatever, when folks came to us as doctors and said, hey, you know, this handwriting thing doesn't make a whole lot of sense. We need to come up with electronic medical records. We sort of ignored it. So, you know, in the labs of Epic and Cerner and Allscripts, without a lot of our input, they created the EMRs, and then we complained about it. I think the new digital revolution will require true partnerships between consumers, healthcare entities, and those entrepreneurs in Silicon Valley and beyond, so that literally at Jefferson, we are actually embedding General Catalyst and others into our health system. So we have a large group called Digital Innovation and Consumer Experience, what we call DICE. We're actually asking General Catalyst to take over DICE, and literally so that they will be in our cabinet meetings and actually solving the problems that we need instead of being in a lab and creating products. The concept of going to HIMSS and having 700 or 800 exhibitors give you a Hershey kiss and saying, use my app, I'm going to transform healthcare, I think is one that does not make any sense moving into the future. And here's the other thing. The old math of clinical, how much money am I making by having people come to my hospital, and academic, how much money am I making from tuition, is going to go away. And the new math will be sharing in the trillions of dollars that are spent in healthcare transformation. I want to end with a final mandate. We have to start learning from our mistakes. Just like that guy, we keep making the same mistakes again. And speaking of being stuck in the 90s, we still have an educational paradigm of see one, do one, teach one. Well, again, what we have looked at is how do we really use simulation and really create procedure rehearsal studios? Not a whole lot different than aviation. And in fact, the whole concept of see one, do one, teach one, which is what any surgeon will say is how they've learned, is really the kind of change that we need to get away from. I use this graphic because I learned how to intubate a 1.5-pound baby in the middle of a chaotic delivery room with the dad over me. And for those of you who have ever had to do this, the distance between the trachea and the esophagus, the distance between getting that tube into the right area, is literally a couple millimeters. We now don't let anybody do that until they've proven that they can do it on one of these critters. And the great thing about the way the technology has improved is these 1.5-pound babies scream, cry, they urinate on the sheets, they do everything, and we can monitor them. And we can now say, we're not going to let you do anything on a human until you can prove that that works. And we actually partnered with United Airlines in our simulation center, and it was really interesting. The CEO gave me this great letter that was written by an 8-year-old who sort of got it. She said, "Dear Captain, my name is Nicole. I'm 8 years old. This is my first flight, but I'm not scared. I like to watch clouds go by. My mom says the crew is nice. I think your plane is good. Thanks for a nice flight. Don't up the landing. Love, Nicole." Now, while her mom might not have been thrilled that the only word she spelled right was the one that I crossed out, the fact is that even Nicole got the fact that I'm on your plane. The number one thing that matters is safety, even if I don't know the name. So I think one of the things that we have to get used to in the 2020s is we have to be able to prove that your surgeon is qualified. Now you might say, well, don't you do that now? The answer is no. I'm a private pilot. Every 2 years, I have to get my technical competence assessed, both on a simulator and in the air. Nobody has checked my technical competence in the last 30 years since I was a resident. And by the way, it's true of every doctor in Philadelphia, New York, Wisconsin, California. So we have to get to a model where the technical competence of surgeons is assessed as well as our cognitive competence. So I want to leave you with two quotes, one from the NBA, and I'm really happy that, cross our fingers, that the NBA is restarting in the bubble. And it was from Jason Kidd, who had taken over as point guard for the Dallas Mavericks. The team was 24-52, and he said, "We're going to turn this team around 360 degrees. We've done a lot of turning things around 360 degrees in healthcare, and it's time for us to recognize that this is the time for true disruption." And then also from my other favorite science fiction piece, Yoda, he had this to say.
"Because without getting docs to be more creative, they are doomed. You must make sure that the conference happens. Steve Klasko, an OBGYN doc from Philadelphia, will talk about creativity as a skill set, he will. That program will produce doctors who go home and defeat the dark side of non-creative healthcare. That group became the core group for an optimistic future. Learn what you can from the OBGYN doctor. And may the forceps be with you."
And probably, most importantly, I think the pandemic has proven that we have to start now. So thank you very much. And Dan, I will turn it back to you.
All right. And thanks, Steve. That was wonderful. I don't remember that Yoda clip, but that was a good one. It's kind of funny. You talked about, what was the quote? "Hard to get someone to do things when their salary depends on not doing it." I think I mentioned you. I talked to some advisor in one of the big health providers in Wisconsin and said, and he told me, "Dan, stop using that word disruption. It makes the leadership nervous." And I think if we're going to be going in the direction of telehealth down the road, like you say, we're not going to need all these hospitals. We're going to be disrupting, and a lot of people's jobs are maybe going to go away, and there'll be new jobs. I mean, I guess you see this coming soon. This is going to change the landscape. I mean, who are the barriers to this?
Well, look, I think the barriers are all the people that are profiting from a fragmented, expensive, and inequitable system. And again, I think that, I think I really enjoyed David's preview of the Biden piece, but you know, tweaking the Affordable Care Act is not gonna be enough. I mean, there's just, the bow's gonna break, Dan. I mean, the simple fact is we can't expect pharma profits to go up at the level that they have and continue that way. Insurer profit. I think about the whole, and it seems like I'm picking on insurance. I don't mean to do that, but whether it's hospitals or insurers, us making profits just by having people get sicker and go into beds makes no sense. The whole concept of medical loss ratios, of how much can I get in from the employer at the beginning of the year, and how little do I have to pay out through the year,
right?
It's just an archaic concept. And the pandemic proved that by saying, wow, the pandemic was great because I got all the money in December and November.
Right.
And the fact that all these people didn't get care, and frankly, a lot of the people, that reasons that telehealth isn't paid for, is it would open up the floodgates for people getting care. So if we really want to transform healthcare in this country and give everybody access, it's going to require some folks to think differently, not necessarily get hurt. And I think that's what happened to retail, right? I mean, Target and Walmart did fine with the disruption. Sears and Penny's didn't. And I think those are the kinds of things you'll see in healthcare.
Well, I'm looking forward to that. So some big disruptions. Uber disrupted things. And if we put power in the hands of consumers, the consumers can sort of drive that. So thanks, Steve. Appreciate it very much.
Thank you, Dan.